Hello, this is March 2017. My name is Paul, and this is about Isaac Newton and the Trinity. Often it has been claimed that Isaac Newton was not a Trinitarian and all, so we want to look more closely, in particular, at his writings. Now, according to this article, the top 10 most influential scientists, you can go through the list 1 to 10, but number 1 they list as Isaac Newton. Now, I'm not saying that he was necessarily the greatest of modern scientists or whatever, but he certainly is among the top. However, Wikipedia wrote these words: according to most scholars, Newton was Arian. Now, a lot of people don't know what that means. It means he denies the deity of Jesus Christ, and that is false. And it also went on and said that not holding to Trinitarianism, where there's a technical sense in which that may be true, because the word Trinity is not found in the Bible and that kind of thing. But we can talk about that a little bit later. So the most scholars, as far as I'm concerned, were wrong, because we're going to be looking at Isaac Newton's writings. Let's see what Newton himself actually wrote. Now, you can see his handwriting above. It says, "Rules for interpreting the words and language in Scripture." And that's a reference to the Bible. Notice how he capitalized Scripture even in that handwritten note. He had high regard for Scripture, the Bible. In fact, these words are attributed to him: "I have a fundamental belief in the Bible as the Word of God, written by men who were inspired." In other words, inspired of the Holy Spirit. And he added, "I study the Bible daily." Now, before dealing with the concept of God and the Trinity, let us view one of his rules for interpreting the Bible. You see that heading up there, rules for interpreting the Bible and so on. And rule number 4, you can see it there. It's a little faint, but in the upper left-hand corner of the bottom rectangle, you'll see what looks like a 4. And he said, "To choose those interpretations." Now, you can see interpretation sort of behind the arrow there. And it actually, he originally wrote, "to prefer those interpretations." He wrote "prefer" first, but then above it he wrote either "choose" or "chose." But I believe we're going to go with "to choose those interpretations which most accord to the literal meaning of the Scriptures, unless were the tenor and circumstances of the place plainly required as allegory." Now, going back, you can see that word, that arrow, pointing right to that word "literal" meaning of the Scriptures and so on. And he is saying that one way of interpreting the Bible is to go if at all possible, to the literal meaning. His words, "most according to the literal meaning, support an understanding of Genesis," for example, the first 3 chapters, "that is not allegorical." A lot of people would say it's allegorical, but he said, "let's give preference where possible to the literal." And Genesis 1 to 3 certainly can be understood in a literary way. Regarding creation itself, Newton is famous for his words in his famous book, The Principia, and it's there in that image to the right: "This most beautiful system of the sun, planets, and comets could only proceed from the counsel and dominion of an intelligent and powerful being." He was a genius. And yet he also had a love for Scriptures. Now, let me go back to that. Last July 2016, on the 25th, I wrote to the librarian at King's College, Cambridge. And the reason is because I knew they had the Newton's handbook. However, they were charging a pretty expensive fee for just one page. It was page 12, and they wanted 25 lira or pounds or whatever, which would be equivalent today to $30, but, you know, maybe 50 back in July. But I had to drop that, and I'll explain why. I wrote to him, "As things presently stand, we cannot do business." I'm going to explain why. Instead of happily allowing images of Newton's words to get out, you apparently want to clamp down on dissemination. I was willing to pay for the image of page 12, but now you want to control my use of that image. When a person buys a painting, should the artist have the right to tell the owner that he can never take a picture of the artwork? So I continued in the letter, "Are you or your boss Unitarian?" You see, that page shows that Newton is Trinitarian. And so maybe one of the reasons they want to hide it is, or something, or make it difficult, maybe some people there at the university are Unitarian. And I added, if so, then that might help me better understand what's going on. Unitarians deny the Trinity, do not affirm the deity of Christ or Jesus, but those pages from Newton's notebook show many verses which affirm Christ's deity. Unitarians probably do not want people to know that Newton, of course one of the greatest scientists, was not a Unitarian. And that's often said. When you read about Wikipedia and so on, Newton, he wasn't a Trinitarian and that kind of thing, which is really, I believe, a misrepresentation. And so I continue in the letter, "As it is not used in the Bible." He didn't like the word, because Trinity is not used in the Bible. But that does not mean he did not believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. He gave Deus Filius, God the Son, as title to that page, the one that I wanted. And his very first verse, coming from Romans 9:5, applies the words, quote, "God blessed forevermore, amen, to Jesus Christ." The next passage is from Philippians 2, where it says, "Every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord." That word Lord has Yahweh as the Old Testament backdrop. There are many other wonderful passages in that section that pose a challenge to Unitarianism, but they didn't want me to copy or, you know, show that it's personal use and kind of thing. What right do they have for that? I don't know the answer to that question. Anyway, there's a picture of the library that we're dealing with, King's College, Cambridge. And he had sent me an attachment, and in that attachment it said, "I declare that I shall not use the copy except for research or private study. I shall not make nor permit to be made any further copy from the copy that you supply me with in response to this request." Well, I didn't go along with it. I decided to drop this because I wanted to share with many what Newton had said. So I concluded my response to Dr. Clements with, "Today, I became increasingly aware of King College's censoriousness and or money is all philosophy." If you take a look at that form at the lower right, that's the price they wanted me to pay for one page. And it's more than 25 pounds. But it is interesting that that document that he sent did actually provide evidence that Newton had used the phrase Deus Filius, Latin for God the Son, which is not affirmed by Arians nor Unitarians. And you can see that phrase right there, with the red arrow is pointing to it. Now, while still dealing with the issue of Newton's rules for interpretation, and I want to get into that notebook that he had soon, but let us consider what he wrote about the Holy Spirit. Most of this is going to be about Jesus, but he also believed the Holy Spirit was God, the Holy Spirit. Rule 14 contains the thought that the Holy Spirit sees, he observes. Let me actually give you the fuller context. Newton wrote, "If historians divide their histories into sections, chapters, and books at such periods of time where the less, greater, and greatest revolutions begin or end, and to do otherwise would be improper, much more ought we to suppose that the Holy Ghost observes this rule accurately in his prophetic dictates, since they are no other than histories of things to come." So Newton is talking about the Holy Spirit who observes and his prophetic dictates and so on. The Holy Spirit is a person as far as Newton was concerned. The word holy is not capitalized, but the word ghost is. And the ghost, the Holy Spirit is a person. Now, even though I did not get the handwritten copy that I wanted from the library at Cambridge, there is an extremely helpful link which reveals the sense, digitization, and publishing back in 2003 of Newton's own theological notebook. And it was a notebook written in his own hand. And it's called The Newton Project. And if you go to the article on my webpage, you can actually get the link. The project has made at least some of Newton's writings available online. Now, they didn't give the copies of his handwritten work, but they did digitize it. And I commend them for this effort. I don't know much about the Newton Project, but I commend them. In his theological notebook, Newton gave three major headings. Deus, Pater, God the Father, Deus Filius, God the Son, and Spiritus Sanctus, Deus, God the Holy Spirit. Thus, all three persons of the Godhead are considered in his own handwriting. He called it attributa dea, attributes of God, and the first part relates to Deus Pater, God the Father. A key factor, however, is the second heading, Deus Filius, God the Son. Did Newton believe Jesus was indeed God the Son? He most assuredly did, for the section is full of quoting scripture affirming Christ's deity. For example, we've already mentioned Romans 9, but there's the yellow words, "Of whom the Jews, as concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, God blessed forevermore. Amen." Romans 9, 5. Though that's Newton's handwritten words. The way he renders that verse, if you sort of bring it together, is Christ is God. Newton was not stupid, and Unitarians do not believe Christ is God. The excuse that some use for saying that Newton did not believe Christ is God, an Arian tenet, surrounded the word consubstantiality. Newton did not think the word made a lot of sense, plus the Greek word homoousios is not found in the Bible. The Latin word consubstantialis was coined by Tertullian 200 years after the first century, or 200 AD. And I join Newton in having reservations about Tertullian. Tertullian actually referred to Plato to promote the notion that humans have innate or natural immortality. But both Plato and Tertullian were wrong. As Jesus said, for example, he said that the body and soul both may be destroyed in hell. Jesus was not teaching implicit or inherent immortality. In fact, immortality is a gift that he gives to his believers. But that doesn't mean that everybody has immortality. Now, Newton quoted many classical passages that are used to affirm the deity of Christ. And I list some of them there. I put quotations around Colossians 1:15 because that's the way he abbreviated Colossians. And there are many there, but I don't intend to get into them all. And of course, there are many that I haven't even listed. He quoted John 8:58. Now listen to this, and I'm quoting, this is what he wrote with his hand. Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. John 8:58. Newton wrote those words with his hand. And in that passage, the Lord Jesus was claiming to be the I am of Exodus 3. And Newton lists that verse under God the Son. He also hand wrote these words, we are in him that is true, in his Son Jesus Christ. This is the true God, 1 John 5:20. Condensing this, you have Newton writing in his hand, Christ is the true God. Newton was quoting this verse to affirm the deity of Christ. He was not an Arian or a Unitarian. He wrote, Christ is called light. And there are many passages there. That I've got it in quotation. He wrote them, hand wrote them. Notice how saturated Newton was with Scripture. Again, he wrote, Jesus answered, my Father works here too, and I work. Therefore, the Jews sought the more to kill him because, and the word because there, he left off the word e. But these are personal notes that he wrote to himself. He said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Notice the double L on equal. I'm quoting what Newton wrote. He was affirming Christ's deity, not denying it, like the Arians and Unitarians would. Newton wrote, Christus Jehovah dictator. Christ is Yahweh, or Jehovah. And he wrote about this Jeremiah 23:6, Jehovah our righteousness, a very beautiful passage, prophetic of the coming Christ. This is hardly affirming Arianism. Newton was neither an Arian, and Wikipedia's estimate above is an error. The Jeremiah passage is about the Messiah, and Newton was affirming that Jesus is the promised Messiah. In fact, Newton was a genius, and I'm not saying I'm a genius, but we had similarities. For example, he loved math. He was the chairman of, or they had a chair at, for mathematics. And I taught mathematics for 30 years, but I also wrote about Jehovah Jesus there. And I did long before I even knew that Isaac Newton had prepared this theological handbook. I used many of the passages that Newton used. He was right on. He wrote, the angel of the Lord called unto Abram out of the heaven and said, now I know that you fearest God, and so on. Of course, he puts a double L on angel there, and so on and so forth, but we can forgive him. This is his personal notes. But that passage in Genesis 22 is magnificent. It's about the angel of the Lord and the wonderful promise that was made to Abraham and so on. So there were other passages, scriptures there. I'm not going to read the whole thing. Notice, the angel of the Lord, or Christ, and if you go back to the previous thing, you'll see that in the middle part of that paragraph, you'll see that he says that Christ, or the angel of the Lord, is from the midst of a bush, and then God is in the midst, calls out from the midst of the bush. I pointed that out in my book. There's a connection between the angel of the Lord and God himself. In other words, the angel somehow is distinct from God, but is also God. And then Newton referred to the passage in Daniel 7:13, which is another magnificent promise of the coming Messiah. He talked about the Father and Son there. This is Trinitarian thinking, even though he didn't like the word Trinity, because it wasn't in the Bible. So he avoided using terms that were not, didn't have the sanction of Scripture or the Holy Spirit. And I've already mentioned that book, which is available. In fact, if you contact me and you don't have money to pay for the book, I'm happy to send it to you free. Notice next Newton's use of the phrase Christ is as God. He wrote, and I'm quoting Newton, handwritten, what he wrote, both he that sanctifieth Christus et Deus, Christ as God, and they that are sanctified are all of or from one, the Father, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Again, misspellings, at least as far as we, but this was centuries ago that he wrote, and we're not sure what the conventions were back then. Well, at least I am not. Newton had a section, Christi Incarnato, Christ's incarnation. This is in harmony with the deity of Christ concept. Jesus did not start when he was incarnate, conceived in the womb. He pre-existed. He's been from all eternity. Newton believed, I am certain that he believed that Jesus is eternal. He took on human flesh. Newton wrote, quote, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And there are many other passages there. Notice again, Colossians, this time is abbreviated slightly different from his previous abbreviation for Colossians. Imagine a supposed Unitarian saying that all the fullness of the Godhead bodily was in Christ. Newton also wrote, Christ, the only begotten Son of God, in respect to his miraculous birth of the Virgin by divine power without a father, and so on and so forth. Many passages which I'm choosing to skip over. And of course, I've selected only some of what Newton himself had wrote. It's a rather large handbook that he had written. In the above paragraph, Newton wrote of Christ's divinity and of the fact that many Jews did not expect their Messiah to be more than a man. In fact, you can watch my debate against Rabbi Tobias Singer in New York some years ago, and that's one of the points that I made to Tobias Singer, an Orthodox Jewish rabbi. That one of the main differences between Orthodox Jews and Christians is Jews believe that the Messiah, Orthodox Jews, is a mere man, is not God. But Christians affirm that Jesus, the Messiah, is fully God, and that's exactly what Newton was affirming as well. He wrote, Jews did not expect their Messiah to be more than a man. He was affirming that Jesus was God the Son, Deus Filius, and that he was and is divine. He had another section dealing with this Holy Spirit, and there gave many passages about the Holy Spirit. But I'm only going to include one here. He wrote, go, teach all nations. This is quoting, this is digitizing Newton's handwriting. And then, quoting Newton, go. Teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, Matthew 28:19. This is a classic passage often used to affirm the Trinitarian doctrine. The fact that he used lowercase here for ghost should be seen as his writing personal notes to himself. There are a variety of unusual spellings in his personal notebook, and even we, when we do a search, for example, about Jesus on Google, we might not even capitalize Jesus, Jesus there. Google doesn't even want you to capitalize it. It'll change it to a lowercase. This is the final slide. Did Newton keep consubstantiation at a distance? Yes. Because it was not a biblical word. Did Newton believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit? He most certainly did. Was he a true Christian? I wish more Christians were devoted to the study of God's Word and devotion to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit as Newton was. I believe that I will get to see Isaac Newton in heaven because I believe he trusted in Jesus and his sacrifice and the wonderful truths found in God's Word. Lord Jesus, I pray that you might use this video for your glory. Touch hearts. Draw them to yourself. Help them to realize that this great scientist would appear from his handwritten notes that he also was one who was a believer in Jesus Christ. Bless this video with all its defects and my weakness and so on for your glory, and may Jesus Christ, who is perfect, be exalted. May we worship him and adore him, not only for his wonderful work of salvation on the cross and for coming alive again 3 days later, but for his wonderful creation of the heavens and the earth. In Jesus' name, amen.